For Krima Media in Johannesburg, I'm Sane Dlamini. Longest serving DA leader Tony Leon is in conversation with Polity about his second book titled Future Tense, Reflections on My Troubled Land. Mr. Leon, your book tries to cover your political involvement in different positions you have occupied. And at the same time, you share your views on the many episodes our country has been faced with. When did it occur to you that this book was vital?
Well, it was suggested to me actually by Jonathan Ball, who very sadly died after a struggle with cancer. So I'm very sorry about that, obviously. And this was the last book he actually commissioned. He just felt that, you know, obviously a lot of books about South Africa, the current situation, the future, but a book written by someone who'd actually been in the room or in several of the rooms, Sane, when events were being determined that would decide where we were going, right back to when de Klerk made his speech in 1990, which changed the National Party's policy radically in one 40-minute speech, to the constitutional negotiations, which I was involved between 1991 and 1996. And then the first Democratic Parliament, when I was, after which I was elected leader of the Democratic Party, and then the Democratic Alliance. So I was in a lot of those situations, and I had obviously a lot of encounters with Nelson Mandela, Jacob Zuma, Thabo Mbeki, Cyril Ramaphosa. And I wanted to put some color into what is normally a black and white picture, because either you get a lot of statistics and facts, which are very important, and there are, I have to say, 460 footnotes here, so this book is not just a fact-free universe, but also because you can't really know what happened if you really weren't around at some critical hinge moments when our history was being written. And I was fortunate enough or privileged enough to have been in some of those critical moments, which did give me a perspective. And also, of course, being outside now of the party political arena, because I stood down from parliament and my party leadership in 2009, gives you a sense of perspective or distance, if you like. And so I was able to reflect. And obviously, the impetus for this book was hastened by, perhaps this is one of the positives out of a very negative situation, the imposition of the lockdown during coronavirus, because the writing project sort of kept me sane in the afternoons.
You're also the longest serving leader of the DA. You also write about the leaders who have led the party after you had left. Are you proud of what the DA has become?
Well, let me say this, that the DA is very necessary for the democratic health of the country, because it is the largest opposition party in the country, and that's been determined at every election since 1999. I mean, it is, as you know, Sane, a very crowded field, the opposition. There's one big governing party and there, I don't know, dozens and dozens of opposition parties. And the DA has held the ring as the principal opposition party for the last 22 years in our history. So if you're going to have an effective democracy, if you're going to have a government kept to account, you need a strong opposition. And in that sense, I think the DA has played and continues to play a very important role. Of course, there's going to be a lot of comment and criticism about how it's played, but I think you've also got to be aware of the environment in which it's operating. This is not a country that is conducive to opposition politics, because you have a very dominant one party, governing party. At the last election, despite everything, the 9 wasted years, the lost decade, whatever you call it, the ANC still got nearly 40 points more than the next party, which was the DA, on the electoral results screen. And also, it's not just that the government controls the government, the governing party wants to control all of society. So I think sometimes it's a tough swim in those waters, but I think it's very necessary for the health of the country to have a strong party that's different from the governing party. I mean, if you just replicate the ideology of the ANC in opposition form, then you've got to say, well, you might as well vote for the real deal, which is the ANC, not some facsimile version of it.
It's interesting at how you looked at Maimane compared to other previous leaders.
Musi gets both a positive and a negative write-up in my book, which is entirely appropriate. I spend some pages describing, I think, in very considerable detail, his positive qualities, which propelled him to the front, and then the negatives, which propelled him out of the party and out of his position. As to the so-called line that's trending on social media, I never said it in the book at all. So, but most people don't read the book. And what's more, most people commenting never even read the article, which was an interview, long interview in News 24. And then everyone complained, well, we can't read this behind a paywall. Well, I didn't put it behind a paywall. News 24 did, complain to them. Quite unbelievable. But anyway, what I said in the interview, as opposed to what's in the book, and the book is 276 pages that justify that conclusion. I said Musi was an experiment that had gone wrong, as he had never committed to the party's ideals before he joined it. In other words, if you make a person the leader, when he'd never voted for the party in three previous elections, when he'd voted against the party, and then you appoint the same person as the leader of the opposition on the same day he's elected to parliament for the very first time, well, that is going to be at some risk. If it goes right, it'll be a wonderful thing. If it goes wrong, it'll be a very bad thing. And it went wrong, for the reasons I elaborate in this book. And how anyone, except in the most grotesque and distorted way, could suggest that this is some sort of imputation on his humanity or something, I think is quite frankly bizarre. You know, it's beyond reason, actually. You know, I was struck by the fact that Musi was complaining about being dehumanized by a remark, incidentally, which I just went and looked at our friend Mr. Google. I saw that Tony Blair had called Jeremy Corbyn, his successor, a dangerous experiment if he ever got elected. And Donald Trump was described as a real live political experiment after he was elected. So why Musi should be so precious in using a well-known phrase that's been applied to many political leaders of greater stature than him, such as the President of the United States or the leader of the opposition in Britain, is actually extraordinary. Unless you, of course, intend to decontextualize it in order to make another point. And, you know, I also remember very recently that the current leader of the DA, Steenhuisen, like Musi, is a practicing Christian, and Musi called him a Judas. Well, I mean, you call someone a Judas. That's a dehumanizing remark.
You also speak of an incident where you visited Maimane's office, and there was a picture of Nelson Mandela in his office. It sounded as a bit as if you were shocked about that. What was that all about?
I've got plenty of pictures in my office at the time with Nelson Mandela. I had a very good relationship with Nelson Mandela. In fact, I even wrote a book about him called Opposite Mandela in 2014, because we had although we were on different sides of the aisle, we had a very close relationship. Now, I was rather struck there with these two. It wasn't a photograph. Everyone has a photograph of Mandela these days, because he was such an iconic, extraordinary, gifted leader, as I reflect in this book. And I know whereof I speak. Mine is not a reflected view. It's a real-time personal view based on my own encounters with Mandela. I was just struck by, he had these two portraits that were paintings of him and Mandela in the same size and done the same way, which suggested actually they were two peas in a pod. And I thought that was a little bit of an overstretch.
And with the pandemic now affecting the whole world, you write that 2020 presented an opportunity for the ruling ANC to reset the economy. Do you think that they rose to the occasion?
Well, I think they might have risen to the occasion the wrong way, because a lot of the stuff coming out of the economics from coronavirus, if we can put it that way, Sane, was, I thought, very negative, because obviously we've got huge problems and they aren't the government's fault, let me add. I mean, you know, this lockdown, you know, we saw, you know, 3 million people lose jobs. We've seen something like 30,000 establishments, small business establishments, close and be shuttered. We've seen a lack of investment, which, quite aside from the problems that have occasioned South Africa's investment profile before, have been exacerbated by this. So I'm not for a moment suggesting it's all the ANC or the government's fault, and that book makes that quite clear. What I thought was the wrong call, and you can look at people, and I mentioned her in the book, Inkosasana Dlamini Zuma, saying, well, this is, maybe we should commit class suicide in order to have an economic reset. And, you know, Cyril Ramaphosa has been talking about radical economic transformation, JZ's playbook line. And I thought, why would you use pandemic economics in order to perfect a kind of socialist agenda when actually the investment South Africa needs is capitalist, not socialist. The investors don't get attracted here when we amp up the revolutionary language. That's not what you give the kind of words of comfort that people are describing. And I was also struck by one of the other commentators who was a senior person in the South African Communist Party, who said, well, now that the private sector's at its weakest, let's strike, let's move in. Which I thought, you know, this is delusional, because it's delusional thinking in the sense that if we simply crowd out the private sector entirely or significantly, where's the investment going to come from? It's certainly not going to come from the government. The government's coffers are almost completely dry. When I started scratching away at it at the end of 2019, the government was borrowing 1 billion rand every working day to fund the deficit. When I was putting the finishing touches to this book in December, that is just 3 months ago, the government was borrowing 2 billion rand a day for the same purpose. So, you know, this mushrooming of debt in order to largely pay off current expenditure, like public servants' wages and social grants and debt payments themselves, simply crowds out all other initiatives from the government. So the government's got no money. Where's the money going to come from? It's going to come from the private sector. It's going to come from foreign investors, as it always has in South Africa. And if you scare them off or you just make it more difficult, then you're going to be in a full-scale debt trap without any relief. That's my concern when we start talking about resetting the economy.
You also deal with the issue of race. I felt while I was reading there that you were kind of defending Penny Sparrow's derogatory comments towards Black people that she made because of the way she was treated as compared to Mr. Khumalo. Would you kindly explain that, Mr. Leon?
Well, I certainly am not a defender in any manner, shape, or form of Penny Sparrow. In fact, I said there were genuine white racists who transgressed basic norms of decency and threw more jellic night onto the home fires. The most egregious, although not sole example of this, was an obscure KwaZulu-Natal state agent, Penny Sparrow. In a virulent Facebook post on New Year's Eve 2016, she compared Black beach bathers to monkeys. She didn't remain long in obscurity thereafter, but the opprobrium didn't end with her. Now, I said Sparrow proved to be a bird of little brain or empathy, but I said others in the aviary of racial madness were equally busy at work. And I used the contrast, not because she was right and he was wrong, I mean, they're both equally wrong, of a Gauteng government employee, Velapi Khumalo, who said on Facebook that whites deserve to be hacked and killed like Jews, which is, you know, much more extreme than even Penny Sparrow. I mean, he was actually calling for the imminent incitement of murder and violence, however distasteful her remarks are. And what struck me is that Sparrow was, you know, exiled, lost her job, taken off for criminuria charges, and Khumalo kept his job. But more materially, it was what really got me was an ANC, Philip Dexter, was now in the ANC, wasn't then, was, who said Sparrow's views are unmitigated racism, but Khumalo's views were mere prejudice. And I don't think you can start weighing in the scale saying if she attacks Black people's dignity, as she clearly did, and I make that very clear in the book, and he actually calls for whites to be gassed and genocidally murdered like the Jews of Nazi Germany were, that the one is just prejudice in the more extreme case, and the other is out-and-out racism. But, you know, that some people hold that view clearly, and I thought it should be contested.
And how do you feel about how our government has been handling the race card?
Well, I think they use it as a matter of electoral advantage. So whenever the government's under attack, they say, well, it's a white party or this and that. But the truth of the matter is, and here it's not my opinion, because we all have opinions, and of course they're equally valid, and one's not more important than the other. It's actually what folks out there say, and I quote some authoritative polls here, which suggest actually that the most important thing for South Africans, Black South Africans, all South Africans, actually very little difference, is employment, good education, and safety. Those are the three issues. issues like race or the deterioration of race relations even are way down at the bottom of that list. So it's not my opinion. I mean, I suspect it'd be a lot, and I also deal in this book with it's much easier for a white person to say, well, apartheid's something that ended and we should get on with our lives, as opposed to a black person who was the subject of that discrimination, keeping that injury with them because they were the subject of it. And I quote an interesting dialogue between an Israeli writer, David Grossman, and the British novelist Ian McEwan. And I draw some direct parallels where you talk about something that's ended, but or you talk about something that's enduring. It entirely depends on who you are. So I'm not downplaying how prejudice and discrimination are felt and the burden carried by those who are the subject of it. What I am saying is that if you're going to get ahead and deal with the people's needs, jobs, education, and safety, and you keep concentrating on race, well, you're not going to make any progress on the issues that matter. And I guess you could, you know, the decreasing number of white people in South Africa. I mean, in 2030, out of every 100 kids starting school, only one of those children will be white. One out of 100 school beginners in just 9 years' time. That's according to the figures Clem Santa gave us some time back. So actually, whites are disappearing in this country. But if every single white in South Africa was to be expelled, or Mr. Kumalo had his way, something worse would happen to them, would it actually change the dynamics on jobs, education, and safety? No, because that is in the remit. The government can set a moral example and try and get people to be more empathetic, and that's a good thing. But actually, government's core responsibility is to create an environment for economic growth and jobs, create an environment for education outcomes that are excellent, and give people safety in their homes, in their townships, and in their suburbs. And when it fails on all three, as demonstrably it has done, then you're not going to have progress in this country of any sort for anyone.
And in the book, when you address the DA blunders, it comes across as if you were also disappointed with the choices Helen Zille went with in trying to attract the black voters.
Well, I was and I wasn't. Look, I start that chapter on the DA by actually saying that I'd pondered the question very, very hard and long about can a party in an 80% black country be led by a white person? And you know, in the book, which you've gone through very thoroughly, I tell about this interview I had on Hard Talk on the BBC after the 2004 election, where Tim Sebastian, he really asked me the same question 10 times in half an hour that went around the world. He said, you know, how can a white guy lead a party in South Africa? I gave him a thing about non-racialism, but didn't cut the mustard with Mr. Sebastian. So I worked very hard when I was the leader of the party until 2007 to make the party more diverse, more inclusive. Every leader must do that. Otherwise, you'll end up leading a very narrow sect. But how you did it and who you promoted was a judgment call. And I think Helen Zille, she made those calls after I'd left with some of those leaders who left the party or left their post. There were two ways. The one was given voice by my late colleague, who sadly died very suddenly in 2016, Dean Smuts, who said that the party must grow its own timber. In other words, it must have its own saplings, it must have its own forest, instead of just bring someone in because you think they're going to change the dynamic. And I think people who were rushed in without a long background in the party, those tended to become boomerangs against the party itself and against Helen Zille, as she subsequently acknowledged. And I mean, it is strange when you look at the DA and you say, well, this leader left, couldn't be in a very conducive place. I promise you, not in a month of Sundays would the ANC appoint as a leader someone who in three general elections had not voted for the ANC. The ANC practically got to be born into it these days to advance in it. So why the DA thought, well, you know, let's just bring someone in because they might have some qualities, but actually we don't know if they're very sympathetic to the party's principles or values or policies, then you have problems. And that's exactly what happens when you make certain decisions which actually go against what you say you stand for, but you'll end up doing something else. And I, look, it's not for me to say, because all those, well, I do say it because my books, obviously both fact and opinion, but I didn't make those appointments. Helen did, and I think she's reflected on them subsequently, but you'd have to ask her about that.
Let's just zoom on in one of the people that were appointed or that worked with Helen Zille, Mamphele Ramphele. How did you feel about that collaboration?
I thought it was absolutely bizarre, and for a lot of reasons. I mean, first of all, she never joined the party, but Helen announced she was going to be the presidential candidate. Well, there's no such post as presidential candidate, and you know, once again, she was trying to make the party more effective and how it looked. And I have some sympathy for that, and I reflect on that in the book. But really, to take someone who wasn't even prepared to sign a membership card of the party that she was going to, it was absolutely bizarre. And of course, it lasted all of 5 days. So it was really a humiliating exercise for the DA and for Helen, with respect, and for Mamphele, because in her case, she then said, well, no, I'm going back to Hung. And they landed up with, you know, 2 seats in parliament out of 400. So I don't think the voting public was particularly impressed with her somersaults, just as I suspect, you know, for the DA, it actually did less damage because, you know, the DA recovered some ground. But you've got to say to yourself, this is high risk strategy. And so it proved, and a very short term one as well, all of 5 days.
And you were recently asked, Mr. Leon, to help the DA campaign. Were you surprised by that request? And do you think that your appearance made any difference?
The short answer to that is no. Clearly looking at the results, unless I drove voters away, well, that's also possible. Maybe I'm responsible for the fact that the party lost 450,000 votes in the last election. I don't think bringing anyone in at the last minute helps very much. I just thought that there was a difference. They approached me on the eve of the 2019 election, and I said to the guys who approached me in the senior management leadership party, I said, well, look, you've had all these problems the last year. There was the Dalil saga. There was issues. The mayoralty of Port Elizabeth, Nelson Mandela Bay, had collapsed, and Pretoria was under siege, Shwani. So I said, you know, I think there's a lot of voter discontent out there towards us. And they said to me, no, it's all behind us. And then I thought, well, it's strange, it's all behind you. Why are you bringing this old war horse to go and campaign? They said, you know, our traditional supporters need some reassurance. But, you know, as I say in the book, Asana, I'd spent most of my adult life building the DA, or helping to build it, not entirely, certainly not just on my own, but I'd been very much part of those efforts. And I thought, you know, I can't just stand back when the party is clearly in need. But as when they got hold of me, and then they got hold of Helen Zille, who then was had been sent into isolation because of her previous tweets, I thought, well, there's something clearly different between what they're saying to me and what their actual situation is. And I found that out. I mean, I was at a public meeting just 2 weeks before election day. People asked some questions of me and Douglas Gibson, who's also an old veteran of the party, you know, that I said to Douglas, I said, they shouldn't be asking those questions 2 weeks before the election, because they're so uncertain about what the DA stands for, and there's an election 2 weeks' time, then there's a problem. And as the results proved, let me just add that there are 16 chapters in this book, and only 2 of them deal with the DA.
And would you briefly tell our viewers about your relationship with the statesman Nelson Mandela?
Yes, Nelson Mandela, well, you don't need me to tell you. I think the whole world knows it was an extraordinary leader. I said he had, at the end of the book, he had a genius-like ability towards acts of emotional intelligence. I think he's one of the most emotionally intelligent people I ever met. And I'm not just saying that because he's a president or everything else. I thought the thing about Mandela was the very contradictions that he embodied and resolved to an extent that we can ever resolve them. So on the one end, Mandela was an absolute die-in-the-ditch loyalist for the ANC. As he said, when I go to heaven, I'll be looking for the nearest ANC branch. So he was, you know, literally, well, not quite from birth, but I mean, pretty much most of his life until death was ANC. Yeah, that's instead what I found very odd, that the DA was trying to appropriate him. He was definitely not DA, whatever else he was. But on the other hand, at critical moments in the country's history, Mandela transcended his party badge. So, and he did it from the front. He didn't wait for the collective to, you know, agree to something. He led from the front. Hmm. And, you know, whether it was accepting the 1994 election results in KwaZulu-Natal, which were very contested, and the IFP, you recall, officially won them, although some people have doubts about whether that was so.
Yeah.
And there was a discussion in the ANC headquarters, then at Shell House, about whether the, and it's all recorded by Mandela's pollster, Stan Greenberg, who wrote a book about this. You know, mm-hmm. they wanted to call a strike. There's a lot of the ANC guys from Natal, as it was then called, just after the 94 election. And then another section in the ANC NEC said, we must describe the elections as not free and fair. You can imagine what that would be. And as Greenberg writes, Mandela drew the meeting to a full stop. He said, we are going to accept the results in Natal. We're going to accept the results in the Western Cape because the ANC will never be heard to say that it wasn't a free and fair election. That's the first liberation election. And the discussion stopped. Now, that is an act of extraordinary leadership against the grain of what is the sentiment, even in a small meeting in your own party.
Wow.
And then the other thing that I think was so important, if you compare, say, Mandela to Zuma,
mm-hmm.
Mandela was the first, well, he was the first democratic president, so obviously he was the first president to ever be in a situation where the Constitutional Court ruled against him as president. And that was in a case between the Western Cape government and the president over a liquor bill. I mean, it's very small beer today, literally. But it was the first case.
Yeah.
Mandela stood in outside his home in Houghton and said, we're going to accept the judgment of the court, even though I don't agree with it, because the courts are correct. And you compare that, or even Mandela gave actual, you know, went to testify, he was called to testify as a witness in the Louis Late case. And he showed up in court, he was present. He didn't duck and dive and avoid the summons, he went. Even though it was very improper, the president was being summoned by Louis Late to a court case. And Mandela made the point that the rule of law is more important than my position and even the party's position. And the same thing happened with the TRC. So when the TRC report's coming out in 1998, Thabo Mbeki and F.W. de Klerk, Thabo Mbeki was by then the head of the ANC, although Mandela was present, rushed mm-hmm. to court because they didn't agree with the findings to get the publication of the report stopped. Mandela went and endorsed the report and Tutu and called for it to be published. Mm. Now, so there are obviously many, Mandela wasn't a saint and by his own acknowledgement, but I think at critical moments in our early days of democracy, Mandela was a transcending figure, and therefore it's worth reflecting upon him and learning from him. Because we've seen other former presidents who actually cocksnit at the rule of law, at the courts, at the constitution, whatever. Mm. And I'd rather follow the Mandela example than some of the latter examples.
That was Tony Leon in conversation with Polity about his book titled Future Tense, Reflections on My Troubled Land.